Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week we're sturgeon fishing in the California Delta, plus we've got a special segment with the California Department of Fish and Game showing you how they're doing research to make sure our fisheries stay healthy for the future. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television.
It's a perfect morning for sturgeon fishing, and we're on board with Gatecrashers, along with Todd Storm and special guest Dylan Stompe from the California Department of Fish and Wildlife.
We're heading out into the Delta right now on the main river. Gonna do some sturgeon fishing today. We have a small little itty-bitty tide in the morning, and I'm a firm believer in there's no good tides, no bad tides. Tides tell us where we can go, not whether or not we can go. So we're gonna look in some deep water, I'd say at least 60 feet, and hope we have this little breeze we got going in the same direction so it's nice and calm and we can detect those little bites. We're getting ready to get in between these two islands right here. The tide's really small, but to kinda, you know, we need some current, just not too much current, and the way we can kinda speed up what little bit of current that we do have is when we get between these two islands, we've got so much water coming down that it's almost like putting your thumb on a hose and increasing the pressure. So if there's fish in here, we'll get enough current for them so our scent trail will be able to reach them and draw them in.
Yeah, that's a nice fish right there.
Yeah, we're not marking like a ton of fish here, but the nice thing is the fish that we are marking, they're on the bottom, and that's where we need them to be. That's a nice fatty right there. But yeah, so we got a little bit of breeze going today, and before you drop anchor, like say for instance I want to fish like right here, you should, you know, if you got a weak tide, which is what we have today, you got to offset a little bit, drop that anchor a little bit ahead of the wind, that way it'll pitch us back and we'll be sitting right where we want to be, because there's no point in marking fish and pinpointing where they're at if you drop anchor and then you slide off and you know, you want to be in 70 feet and all of a sudden we're in 40. I mean, that's like trying to sell lemonade in the backyard versus on the corner. It's just not going to happen. So we got to set up. First thing we got to do is set up on these fish properly, get a good ambush point.
These are from our Trammel net survey, but using them for sampling out here with rods. So amount of rods that we're fishing, the location, time we start, time we end. That's to get a idea of the amount of effort at each site.
Today we're going to put out some we're gonna do two different baits. We've got both lamprey, and then we've got some good salmon roe. And we got Virginia, she's over here setting the table. And what we're gonna work on is she's gonna set this gear with 20 ounces of lead off the sides, off both sides, and then 16s off the back. And ultimately what we want is about 180 degrees of coverage off the back of the boat. We call this a sturgeon roadblock. Baits don't have to be really big. You know, they're basically a bloodhound with fins. And that's all we need right there. Right, Virginia? In California, we have to fish a barbless hook. I personally like the owner. Owner K hook 7-0, and we just, you know, we basically crush them to make them barbless, and I like it because it, as you can see, that the point comes back at the shank. It's almost like a sloppy circle hook, so when you poke these fish they usually don't come undone. And another way that we like to do our leaders here, we've got, you know, it's around 20-22 inches long, and we've got a 1/2 ounce egg weight, but when you snell them, it's very important to not come out of the back of the hook eye. You want to come out in the front so you can maintain that big gap right there. If you went through the back, it'd be like this, and I think we're gonna hook a lot more if we're kicking that hook outward like that.
Oh.
Could be junk, just by the way it was working. We're looking for like a little bite like that.
So when we catch a fish, we'll take the length, its girth, to try and get an idea of how fat the fish is, what kind of condition it's in. And then I will scan it for a previous tag, and if it doesn't have one, throw on a pit tag, which is a little passive electronic tag that we can scan later on and last a really long time.
And if it's the right size, just below the slot or in the slot, I'll give it a reward tag that's worth 50 or 100 bucks.
So the reward tags go in the just below the top fin on the fish.
And these anglers can send back to us for a monetary reward. And we use that to build a population estimate to try and get an idea of how many fish are in the system.
Rock on track, Matt. Pull some line.
Welcome back to the California Delta. I'm Justin Wolf. The tide is right and we're getting bites.
Go ahead. She hooked it in the middle of our spread, so we're trying to get it outside the spread so that she can land it. And we leave these rods out because most of our fish out here, if you've done this a lot with the right kind of gear, it's going to take 6 to 15 minutes to land anything out here. Go to the house, Todd. Yep. And then once she's got them off the side like she did, you know, we're still fishing over here and we don't want to reel everything in because when the sturgeon do come through, a lot of times they come through in groups. And I loved it. I talked to John Kelly, our sturgeon coordinator for the state, California Department of Fish and Wildlife, and he said they don't school up, but they do aggregate, so we catch them aggregating often.
Here we go. Hey, there's the future. All right. Now we're going to put a pit tag in that guy.
Come here, fella.
Pretty fish. Look how fat it is.
Huh?
Healthy,
cool.
Huh?
Yeah. Good looking one. I always like to hold them kind of head down. They calm down a little bit. Most people know if you lie them flat on their back, they go to sleep. Sharks are the same way. But if you hold them head down, they'll be pretty chill for you. Give them a tag. Put it in right behind the head there. Nice. The tag to confirm.
All right.
And we can
take that tape. You got your tape?
Yeah. Let's put it right against the wall. 84 and a half.
Okay.
What do you think, Virginia?
That's so cute. Hi.
It is a pretty one. All right, we'll take them over here. We like to have fun letting these guys go, so a lot of times rather than just dropping the water, we'll get them right on the surface, give them a little whip, away they go.
Our best chance for getting that fish again is to catch it again and then re-tag it. So either on this, out with Zach, him scanning fish for us, or during our normal Trammel net survey in the fall.
Fast forward a few months and we're nearby on San Pablo Bay with Dylan Stompe and Zach Medinas, along with two Trammel net crews from the California Department of Fish and Wildlife. Their goal is to net numbers of sturgeon for research purposes.
We're gonna grab a GPS point here. So we get the area that we started in.
Area we finished in, we fish for about half an hour. Depending on if we get a snag or something or too many fish, we'll pull it up sooner. So it's a modified gill net. The point is to not actually gill the fish since it's pretty hard on them. So there's extra gill net mesh hung between two panels of larger size mesh material. And the idea is a fish pushes through those large panels and it pulls all that extra gill net through and it creates a pocket on the backside. So those fish will go in and turn sideways. And ideally they're not gilled, so it's a little bit easier on them. It's not keeping them from breathing, basically. Goal is to tag as many sturgeon as we can, but we collect environmental information as well so that hopefully we can figure out when and where these fish are in different locations. And ideally we'll be using this to make some sort of model in the future based off of our catch.
So this gives temperature, water pressure, some salinity by parts per thousand. We have 20.5 degrees, Dylan.
The warmer the water, the more the fish are gonna get stressed out. We're not allowed to tag over 21 degrees. So that's part of the reason why we're fishing down here in San Pablo Bay and not upstream in Sassoon, because up there it's way too hot right now. Bycatch out here, bat rays is our number one bycatch species, which can be a pain to deal with because they want to sting you. Lots of sharks, we get leopard sharks, seven gill sharks, broadnose seven gill, brown smooth hounds, starry flounders, California halibut, diamond turbot, and I think we've gotten one striped bass so far.
Hey, look who we got. Come on, Annalisa, let's see what we got.
51.5.
Oh, we got our target species. Nice white.
Nice. All
right. Yeah.
Healthy one.
All right. Spork length, 94.5.
And a soft spot right here. Put that in there. Push that through.
Got it.
That through.
Tag code HF2635. One's worth $150. Somebody catches this fish, turns it in, they can email me at r3sportfish@wildlife.ca.gov, and we will send them a check for $150, and we'll use the information to help generate a population estimate for white sturgeon and to figure out how many are being harvested.
Whoa! Heck yeah! The rarest of the rare right here. Rarest of the rare. It's a really nice green.
We're on San Pablo Bay, learning how the California Department of Fish and Wildlife conducts research to hopefully increase sturgeon populations for the future.
Beautiful green sturgeon. Again, some people get confused. They think there's a gold sturgeon or golden sturgeon, and then they think there's a green, like they're separate, but they're just different color phases of the same species. You can obviously see where they differ from white sturgeon. Usually a bit more slender. And look at those scutes, kids. Look at those scutes. Super sharp, more of a pointy head. That pointy head kind of gets a little more nubbed out as they get older. Oh, got a bat ray. But just gorgeous. And also too, like you see the lateral scute line? White sturgeon above that would be pigmented. Down the side would be pretty much white or light gray. But look at the stripe he has down his side right here. And also, look at this, kids. Wow. Big green stripe down the middle. Just an incredible fish. Let me get him over here in the water. There he is. So this fish is gonna get an acoustic tag right here. These will last for 7 or 8 years, and we have acoustic receivers on the bridges, up in the rivers, and then out the Golden Gate. So we'll pick up this fish if this fish migrates around the system, and then if it leaves and heads up to a different river.
Yeah, so he's making a small incision to the abdomen where he'll insert this tag, and then he'll throw a couple sutures in, tie it up. Fish will be good to go, and be tagging and tracking him for the next 70 years.
Nice. Now let's go swim around, and that little tag puts that. Basically, it's like a beep train, and when it goes by a receiver, it can hear it, and we'll know this fish went by.
So when they put that acoustic tag, one of the reasons why they didn't put the reward disc on them, these green sturgeon can't keep them, unlike white sturgeon, so that's why they're not put on. Basically, when you do catch a green sturgeon, by law, you're not even supposed to remove them from the water. We're obviously doing research today, so it's a little different protocol, but you catch a green sturgeon, hey, take a photo if you like in the water, take the hook out with the fish in the water, and let them go, let them grow big, and let them make more. When we sturgeon fish, we've kind of adopted a commercial method of, you know, fishing for a sport fish or a sturgeon. And we used to, you know, get a bite,
rear back for the fences and set the hook that way. But we've learned with the advent of some of the gear they have today, most of the reels are powerful enough to where, you know, you're basically gonna, you know, if you get a bite, if you get a bite, you get this little, you know, flick, flick, flick. You're gonna come up and get your hand ready like this. And the next little flick, I mean, just like hitting a baseball, you gotta time it. You're gonna have that rod in your hand, and it's, you're gonna have to fight every bit of muscle memory, fishing muscle memory that you have not to pull back. You get on top of it. When that next little flick goes down, you give it five quick cranks in a punching down motion. Just pop, 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 pop. If you got them, usually around the third or fourth crank, you're gonna get tight. You're gonna go through them a couple more times, slide the rod forward, lean back. We have a barbless hook. One of the biggest mistakes you can make, nice guys especially make this mistake, is when you do get tight. When you do get tight on a fish, your buddy runs up, give me my rod, give me my rod. It's, you're better off to, you know, got a good bend in it, crank down a little more. Once that fish gives you that, whoa, 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 he's gonna bury that hook for you. Cause a lot of times, just cause you're tight, don't mean you've penetrated that fish's mouth. And they've got basically a car tire of a mouth, and you wanna set that hook deep. Once you have that done, rock the drag back a little bit. They're really snug right now to make that penetration. But once that fish is stuck, you know, rock the drag back a little bit, and then you're better to hand it to your friend. Because, you know, with these barbless hooks, you hand it to him too soon, he drops a rod tip, takes the tension off the fish, that fish is bye-bye.
Yes! 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 Yes!
Yes!
Yes!
Woo!
It's gonna lift. Is it gonna go?
Yep.
Lifting, lifting, lifting! Woo!
I didn't think my first sturgeon would be in uniform.
Did you bring your license?
Son, you forgot son. Bring your license, son. This is my first not in the Trammel net. Cool. But that's kind of cheating. Caught a couple hundred that way.
Looks like he's about a slot.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
That's a wicked hook set. So this one will get a pit tag and a reward tag. So next person catch this will get 100 bucks.
And help with some signs.
Yeah. and let us know how many of these are out there.
Welcome back to the California Delta. I'm Justin Wolf.
Oh, Virginia, right there.
So far, we've caught several fish for Dylan Stompe from the CDFW to collect data from and to attach reward tags. And with a little luck and some good bait, we'll catch more.
So we just rub the frog for the bite.
There we go. I love how well this stuff sticks. Really bites in. So when guys are using eel, you know, I've always liked to cut mine a little bit of a diagonal cut. And, you know, some people cut it straight across, but it's only like a little better than a half inch wide. And really all you need is literally just a couple pieces on the end of your hook. Get that one in there. And that's all you need to catch a nice sturgeon.
Yeah, that's a big one.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah.
Oh, he was humping on that too.
Wow. He's over 6 feet, isn't he?
Yeah, he's a good feet.
Yeah, it's a big one.
If not, you're gonna be embarrassed.
No. Yes. Wow.
So our estimates are about half of what they were for 2000 to 2010. So around that period, we estimated around 100,000 slot size fish. Now we're somewhere between 30 and 50,000. So it really helps us when we get more cards returned and more reward tags returned, because it gives us a better, tighter confidence interval. It's more precise estimate. So right now our precision is pretty bad because we don't get a lot of reward tags. So the more that we get back of those, the more report cards we get back, the better estimate we'll have. But in general, we're looking at about half the fish that we had two decades ago.
Whoa.
Oh, yeah. Turn him to the left if you can. Pull him back.
there's a lot of reasons why we've got fewer sturgeon. Obviously, it's a take fishery, so some fish get removed through the fishery. They only spawn during really high outflow years. It's been pretty dry. So our last big spawn years were 2019, 2017, 2011. And we can see that in the fish that we catch. They line up pretty precisely in terms of that age based on their size. So those are a couple of big things. Contaminants in the water don't help. It reduces how many or how good their eggs are.
Oh, there you go.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah.
We can measure the boat later. See, we're okay. Catching that splash?
Yeah.
And I got them right here on this first there. Little vent right here. Okay?
Here, we hold it.
Okay. I'm going to pop a chip in them.
Yeah.
Oh, you did. Okay.
About 70 inches.
Sweet. Wow. So. About 6 feet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. And the water measurement. Nice.
Yeah.
Nice job.
How old is that fish? Estimated.
That fish, around 25 years old.
Wow. Okay, so even though I release a fish, I still have to fill out my tag.
Yeah, so this gives a nice idea. You have to have a tag to fish for sturgeon in California. So ideally, we would know exactly how many fish are being harvested and how many are being caught. If everybody fills out their tag and turns it back in, then we have basically a perfect picture aside from whatever gets poached. We use the tag returns and the total amount caught on the report cards to generate population estimates. And our estimates get more precise with the more cards that we get back. We have to make less assumptions about what all the non-reporting people are doing.
Yeah, so if you catch a fish like that with the tag in it, you can clip it off and either send it into our Stockton office and we'll send you back $50. Or you can email me directly at dylan.stomp@wildlife.ca.gov and I'll make sure you get paid.
Hey, thanks for making the time to watch today's episode, and I hope it was time well spent. Now, if we can help you out with your own fishing, be sure to stop into the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. And remember, without our sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.